Okay, thank you. So first of all, I would like to give some motivation, and the main motivation is the problem of serre. I guess it was posed in 1957. And the problem is, can one describe in group theoretical terms the class, I will call it QP, of finitely presentable groups arising as fundamental groups of complex algebraic manifolds, so smooth, not necessarily proper. So this has some variants that are well known and are interesting also. So it's the case, describes the class of groups arising as the fundamental groups of complex projective manifolds. When I say fundamental group, I mean in the usual topological sense. So this is the class P, and we know that there is a strict inclusion. It's very easy to find, for instance, here the Betti number must be even, so this certainly, and here Z is possible, so certainly this is not the same. Another question is the question of Keller groups. QP quasi-projective groups. So this is the case of Keller groups. It is known that we have an inclusion, and it is still unknown whether we have equality. In spite of the fact that Benoît Clodon has proved that we have equality when the group is linear, so as a faithful linear representation. And let me give another layer of complexity. Introducing the class of orbifold Keller groups that correspond to compact Keller orbifolds, always connected, right? When I consider this. And there is an obvious inclusion. And also, we certainly don't know whether this class coincides. So that's a question. So we have certainly this is certainly a non-trivial question. In particular, Simpson has given the best known restrictions for a group to be a Keller group. And this had motivated his conjecture, for instance, that Hélène explained to us before. So that's a big problem, and I don't believe the solution will be given in the next few years. Even okay, but there is a sub question that is of particular interest. So, and this one seems to be more tractable, in a sense. So, let us look at X quasi-projective manifold over C. If we have Z closed proper algébraïque subset that we assume to be connected, we can consider the following group, that is the image of the fundamental group. Okay, the base point will not be important, so in fact the invariant is more or less the conjugacy class of this group. Nevertheless, I put gamma z of x, so it's a natural subgroup of the fundamental group of x, and I'm interested in the following statement, which I called SSC of X, which is the following: for all Z as above, if this group is infinite, I'm only interested in infinite fundamental groups, because every finite group arises as a pi one of a complex projective surface by by Serre in the same paper. So if this is infinite, then I hope that there is a linear representation in a finite dimensional complex space, so that the image is infinite. So certainly this inclusion you can is easy, but the truth is that I would love to know a counterexample, to know a variety that fails to satisfy the property that I called SSC, and I will try and motivate why this is the case. SSC of X. So. Okay, I don't know any counterexample, any x, so that this is not correct. No, okay, I don't know any couple xz, so that this fails. No uniformity on n. Certainly no uniformity on n, and certainly it can be proved that you could add a uniformity in Z on the other end. Toledo's example does not fail that. It comes with a natural linear representation. It is not residually finite, but it comes with a linear representation. Actually, Toledo's and. The even for subvarieties, it's always true. Actually, as I will explain, so this is more complicated than Toledo example, and I don't know how to find a counterexample, and I am very interested in anything closely related to this. And the reason is, first of all, if pi 1 of x is linear, which means that it has a faithful linear representation, then of course this implies this. So the group pi 1 of x has to be rather complicated. It is non-linear. It has no faithful representation of finite rank. Also, if one believes in this property, and one assumes that the Ethal fundamental group is finite, so that the Ethal fundamental group, that's the Grothendieck fundamental group, or the profinite completion of pi 1 of x, so the limit of it's the limit of all finite quotients of pi 1 of x, this guy, this would imply that pi 1 of x is finite. And this is certainly one of the main open problems, whether this guy is finite, whether it implies that the full fundamental...
I'm confused because there is a theorem of Grothendieck by itself, which is telling us that So pi hat finite.
If pi hat,
is equivalent to saying that there is a finite Ethal cover of x with pi hat trivial.
Yeah, yeah.
And then pi hat trivial for the cover implies pi.
No. Not for the topological group. In particular, yes.
Okay.
So in particular, this would imply. So this guy would imply that there is no simple, infinite fundamental group that occurs in the class QP. So that's certainly something that seems to be very hard to get. And also, I've been interested into that question because if X is a compact Keller manifold, and SSC of X is satisfied, then the universal covering space is holomorphically convex, which is the so-called Shafarovich conjecture on holomorphic convexity. And this inclusion is due to several people, and certainly in the projective case is due to Katsarkov, Pantev, Ramachandran, and myself. Then in the Keller case, I have a paper with Campana and Clodon, and a final paper that gives that question. So this SSC means strong Shafarovich conjecture in a secret way. So I would love to have a counterexample of any kind about that very simple question. And of course, if you okay. I don't know. There is some hope that has been expressed by Katsarkov that this could be provable using categorical Keller geometry, something that, perhaps in 20 years, but okay. So anyway, this is this statement, and I want to see whether I can find a counterexample, and I want to construct Keller groups because we don't have a lot of them. And
did you say what SSC stands for?
Yeah. It's a strong form of the Shafarovich conjecture for holomorphic convexity, and that's a very topological statement. Let's forget about that analytical statement. Just look at that as a purely topological statement on pi 1.
And what was XKCM?
Compact Keller manifold. Yes. Conjecture. Okay. Certainly. Okay. Then what to do? The idea would be in order to construct interesting fundamental groups of Keller manifolds. It turns out that there are several constructions. The best one is you find some, you look at some vibration that is really non-trivial on pi ones, and then you take a fiber, and then you have a chance to have a nice, an interesting fundamental group. On the other hand, if you start with a variety that satisfies SSC, in general taking a subvariety will also satisfy SSC. So this does not lead you anywhere. But there is another kind of construction using orbifolds, orbifold Keller groups. So orbifold Keller groups. Unfortunately, I will have to give some details on orbifolds. And I really want to be as brief as possible. So all orbifolds that we want to consider arise from as quotient, global quotient orbifold, where G acts on X. So G is a topological group, X is a topological space, and the action is proper with finite stabilizers. Proper means that the natural map of G times X to X times X is proper. Okay, so it's a tameness. Actually proper implies if you have a G topological, an ordinary topological group acting on a ordinary topological space, say Hausdorff, proper means that the quotient will be well behaved. Hausdorff in particular. So at least in the topological case. And here, G will come in three kind of flavors. It could be an algebraic group over C, say a linear algebraic group over C. It could be a complex Lie group. It could be a general Lie group, why not? Real Lie group. Acting, and X would come accordingly in three possible flavors. So, say, an algebraic manifold. It could be a complex manifold. It could be a differentiable manifold, and the action being differentiable. I'm interested in the three situation. And then X mod G is then according to the three. A situation, either an algebraic smooth Dehlin-Mumford stack. It can be, so if you don't know what a stack is, this is not important. So it would be a complex analytic. And here it would be differentiable. And to say this is a stack means that this is a geometric object, but we just want to look at the G equivariant geometry of X. And we want to forget about the rest. In particular, we can change G, we can have different kind of presentation for G, but we concentrate only on the G equivariant geometry. So, okay. And what is an orbifold? So that's extremely easy. When we have this construction, since we are doing equivariant geometry, we have an equivariant map of X to X mod G, which is well defined as an algebraic space, an analytic space, or why not a topological space with only quotient singularities. Let's call this M, and let's call it, let's give it a name, it's the moduli space of the quotient stack X modulo G. And essentially, this map has the following property. It has very simple fibers that I will describe. The fiber of M over the orbit GX bar is nothing than the following quotient stacks: X bar, which is a point, divided by G of X bar, where G of X bar is the stabilizer of X bar in G. So it's a finite group. And the fibers are just quotients of points by finite groups. So they are essentially points whose category of sheaves are just GX bar sets. Okay? So now an orbifold is something like that. By definition, if G of X bar is trivial generically. So we have an ordinary space, and at each point we have, of this ordinary space, we have attached a group, a finite group. And of course there is some more gluing to do in order to organize the structure, but that's all. So, okay. Then certainly we can promote X to be a scheme, a C analytic, a complex analytic space, a general topological space. And this will give rise to various flavors of stacks. The simplest one is topological Dolin-Mumford stacks. That were very much, there's a good reference, which is a preprint by Nui in 2005. And it has never been published, in spite of the fact that it's extremely useful. Okay. And he explained, in this preprint, he explains why you can do homotopy theory with topological stacks, basically, at least in the Dolin-Mumford case, with exactly the same way you do homotopy theory with ordinary CW complex or simple Lichel sets. That's, so let me explain. In particular, you can define a pi one of such a stack, and I will explain how to define this pi one. Let me give right away the result. if we look at the map X over X mod G, it should be thought of with the action of G on the right, it should be thought of as a principal G bundle. In particular, let's say X is connected. There should be, for the homotopy groups of these guys, the long exact sequence of homotopy. So I will define the fundamental group by using the long exact sequence of homotopy in that particular case. So since it is a group, it's pointed. And let us say that if this guy, let's define the fundamental group by saying that it has such an exact sequence. Of course, it does not quite fix this guy, but it certainly permits to compute. For instance, if the group here is discrete, and say X is simply connected, then we see that it's pi zero of G, and we recover the usual description of the fundamental group and universal covering space. And okay, this enables to do the computation. What you can do, I will say it, if you really want to give a right definition, what you should do is that you should form the groupoid of the action. So the groupoid of the action will have the X as objects and G times X as arrows with two maps. One is identity. And then, so when you form this groupoid, you can form the nerve of the groupoid. Okay? And then the nerve of the groupoid will be a simplicial topological space. And you can take its topological realization. It gives a good space, a good homotopy. And this is the homotopy type of this space, is the homotopy type of the stack. Right? In particular, if you do this with BG of X, that will be my second example, you recognize exactly the Milnor construction of the Eilenberg-MacLane space of GX. And this stack is connected as fundamental group equals to G of X, and it's an Eilenberg-MacLane space, so it has no higher pi I if GX is finite. In particular, this gives for us maps from GX, let's call it AX, to pi 1 of x, and g of x should be viewed as a kind of internal fundamental group of the point x in the stack. And this internal fundamental group of the point is non-trivial, it's a finite group, and it maps to the fundamental group of the stack, of x minus g. If you really look at what happens, you get a map like that, and there are two flavors. There are a very classical proposition. Probably it's due to Thurston. It will tell you that if you have, say, a differentiable orbifold. Then this orbifold can be represented as the quotient of the pi of by the pi one of a simply connected manifold if and only if all gx, all this inertia map are injective. This corresponds actually to discrete Lie groups, right? Not positive dimensional Lie groups, dimension zero Lie groups, discrete Lie groups. So that's one nice property of a Norby fold. Also, a second property is that x is x mod g, where g is finite, acting on x manifold. Let's call it x prime. It's not the same as g prime. If and only if all inertia morphisms in the profinite completion are injective. Okay. Now, this is a very desirable property, which is called uniformizability of key. And it turns out that if you have an orbifold Keller group, that is the fundamental group of an uniformizable Keller orbifold, I will define briefly Keller orbifold, then it is a Keller group. That's extremely easy to prove. So certainly most orbifolds tend to be uniformizable, more or less. It's hard to find a non-uniformizable orbifold, actually. And so orbifold Keller groups tends to be Keller. Besides, since this is related to the fundamental group, it can be showed that if you have the fundamental group of a compact Keller orbifold, and the fundamental group is residually finite, which means that the pi 1 injects into the pi 1 hat, and it can also be proved to be a Keller group. So in general, orbifold Keller groups are Keller groups. I did not define an orbifold Keller group. It will be enough for us. Okay. In fact, we are in the complex analytic setting. So G acting of X with finite stabilizer. This means that the orbits of G determine a foliation, and the Keller metric is a transversal Keller metric that is invariant by the foliation. Okay. So that's the definition. Now, the main property is when is that actually if X mod G is a quasi-projective manifold, it is a priori an algebraic space. Okay, then when X mod G is a quasi-projective orbifold, then the stack X mod G here, the quotient stack, the quotient orbifold, say, is Keller. Okay. So basically, all of our Keller orbifolds, say compact Keller orbifolds, will be will come from algebraic the Dunning-Mumford algebraic stacks whose moduli space is a projective manifold. Okay, that's what we have to know about that. Okay, so. Now, let me give a more serious example. And that's the main example of the talk, in a way. Let's take X to be a complex manifold. let's assume that D is a smooth divisor. And, okay, so it's non-empty, certainly, so I look at the natural section defining this divisor, let's call it SD, and I view SD as a function FD that lives on the total space of OX of minus D with values in C. So this is just a holomorphic function, right? I view the section like that. And I consider P to be this total space minus the zero section. P is a principal bundle of the multiplicative group, and the quotient, as you know, is X. Right? Now we will change. We will make a slight variation by introducing an integer, say greater than 2. And we define PW to be the set of P zeta. So it's included in P times C, such that zeta to the n is FD of P. It turns out zeta to the W. It turns out that we have an action on P of W of the multiplicative group, which is given by the following formula. And this is certainly a proper action with finite stabilizers. Actually, the quotient space is nothing but X, but the stabilizers are trivial if X is not in D. At exercise, the stabilizers are the root of unities of order W if X is in D. So this corresponds to ramifying at order W along D. Okay? And this I call X divided by PW divided by C star. So okay. So let's call it, I'm sorry, let's call it X of racine W of D. So this is actually a construction by Vistoli. So the root stack of a divisor. Actually, this construction of Vistoli can be amplified. Okay, you can do the exercise. It's easy to prove. Assume that we have a simple normal, a normal crossing divisor. Not simple. Assume that we have a vector of weights, and then there exists one and only one complex orbifold. Such that its moduli space is X, and such that the map the moduli map ramifies at order wi on di. It is important that this is smooth. Okay? And I will describe it in I will describe why it is important in the following example. And these are the Bogomolov-Katsarkov examples. Then, No, it is unique. It is unique up to equivalence, and it is uniquely prescribed by the fact that it is smooth. I will explain. It's really important that it is unique. Okay, so let me explain this example. So the example are the following. Let us take a surface which is a fiber over a curve, say a projective surface, fiber over a curve, and let us assume that it is a stable a stable curve. It means that the only singular fibers are nodal, and I make the hypothesis that they are stable. Okay, that's just for simplifying the statement. But let's take what we have is that we have the surface S, we have the curve C, and we have the critical locus of pi, where the fibers are stable nodal curve. Let's call sigma here the generic curve, and these are the stable curves. And since sigma endowed with the preimage of the critical locus, this is certainly a simple normal crossing, a normal crossing divisor. We can construct S pi minus 1 of B, and for a specific reason, I want the ramification weight along this guy to be constant. And this, let's call it SDP. For P, an integer. Okay, and I claim that this is, okay. SDP as a stack is not, you could define here, you don't really use the fact that D is smooth except to prove smoothness. If you accept singularities, then you could do the root stack of B. You would get Z over PZ has isotropy all along the fiber. Here, what we do is that we put Z over PZ as isotropy along the fiber, and here at that point, we put this as isotropy. That's the only way to make it smooth. If you try to do a root stack, it would be singular. A Vistoli type, without prescribing. So there are several possibilities for prescribing ramification, and here I take, in some sense, a maximal ramification. Right? So let's look at these surfaces SD of P. And let me give the main properties of these surfaces as were proved by Bogomolov and Katsarkov. If P, say, is odd, or P greater or equal than to 4, SD of, no, P is divisible by 4, if even, SD of P is uniformizable. So its fundamental group is a Keller group. Then the fundamental group has the following exact sequence. So this is an orbi curve, and with the property we can always assume that it is an hyperbolic orbi curve. So it is given by the quotient of the disk by a Fuchsian group. And here we have the group IP of P, which I will describe. It is the quotient of the fundamental group of the generic fiber by the normal subgroup generated by these objects, where M is a monodromy group, which is contained in out plus of pi 1 of sigma, and C alpha are the vanishing cycles of pi transported to sigma. Okay, then Bogomolov and Katsarkov had some musing that this guy was infinite, but they were not able to prove it. They had the idea that if one killed all p powers of all elements, it would be a Burnside type group associated with a surface group. And it is known for free groups that Burnside type groups can be infinite. So this is still open. And they had also the idea that it could fail to satisfy Shafarevich conjecture. And actually, they would fail to satisfy this SSC of X for essentially the Z equals the singular fibers. Okay, so they had this idea. And in fact, this is nevertheless wrong. And this is a theorem that I proved with the topologist, the Grenoble topologist Louis Funard, and which is in the course of being verified by us, so it's not yet on archive. That actually,
it's a theorem.
So that's the theorem at the very end of the talk. The theorem at the very end of the talk is that actually SSC. So let me say for p odd, and p is greater than 5, SSC of SDP under this this hypothesis holds. And actually, okay, also SDP, so we know it is uniform example, and actually the universal covering space is Stein. So in this, so this is a mysterious group, and the only obvious linear representation comes from here. So we, in order to prove the to prove the theorem, we have to produce a specific representation, and the specific representation comes from embedding SD of P inside a stack which is more or less, okay, this works for stack, which is the Knudsen-Mumford compactified of so the moduli stack of once-pointed genus G curve. That is the boundary, which is a normal crossing divisor, and this is a weight P. And the representations come from here. So let, I don't know, okay, I don't know. Let's call this guy MG1 bar of P. And they come from here. And they come from TQFT representations of the pi 1 of M1G, which is a mapping class group of the surface sigma 1 of G. Let's say a pure mapping class group. So here we use really a TQFT representation. In particular, what happens is that the TQFT representation of this group has infinite image. The fact that the TQFT representation of this group has infinite image is a theorem, and that this group is infinite actually, is a theorem of Coberda and Santarubán. That you will find in Invenciones 2 years ago. And this is a really remarkable topological theorem that actually exactly implies here. So the fact that, okay, I stop here. Thank you for your patience.
Questions?
Yes?
Okay. Can I try to formulate the question before you answer it? So we take X to be a product of Z with P1, and Z is Toledo. Toledo's example.
Yes.
So so what's wrong? I mean, Toledo's fundamental okay. group is
so
infinite.
So what happens with Toledo example?
No, can I...
Okay.
X is not Toledo, Z is Toledo, and X is Z cross, for example, an elliptic curve or P1.
Yes.
Okay, so let's say P1. Then,
yes.
Then the fundamental group of Z is the same as the fundamental group of X. And
yes.
Clearly, the image is infinite because that is a fundamental group
no,
itself.
No, 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 no.
And nonetheless, pardon me.
Okay, so you have Toledo example. And you make a product with P1, right?
For example, yeah. It's just a, okay. And the whole stuff we denote by X. And Z is Toledo.
Okay.
Okay. Now, the image of the fundamental group of Z into the fundamental group of X is just the fundamental group of Z. It's just an isomorphism.
Yes.
So, by Toledo's construction, this image is infinite.
Yes.
And I understood that the fact that his group is, this fundamental group is not profinite, is also, but now it's a question to you, which earlier on you didn't answer, is whether the fundamental group of Toledo has infinite
linear representation.
Linear representation. But I thought it does not. And this was the way I had formulated the question during your lecture. What about the linear representation of Toledo's examples? And I thought the linear representations of Toledo's examples are finite or even trivial.
I don't think so. Toledo example, you start with a certain quotient of a domain of type 4. And you so it's you know it's a K3 domain.
Ah, okay.
Okay. So and then what you do is that you take a hypersurface in a totally geodesic hypersurface, totally geodesic hypersurface in that big omega mod gamma, right? And then the important point in Toledo example is that you can contract the divisor to one singular point.
Singularity, yeah. And take something compact.
And then
outside.
You take something compact here that has the same fundamental group of than the complement. So the complement of that guy has the same fundamental group as Toledo's example. But you know, by construction, Toledo's examples comes with a map to omega mod gamma, which is a group of orthogonal type. Let's say K. So, Toledo's example is also a subvariety of the big Shimura variety complete here. And so there is no problem. There is a natural representation that comes from the compacty that come. Okay, so Toledo example is when is the fundamental group of that guy is the fundamental group of the complement of a totally geodesic divisor in this big variety. But this is much bigger than the fundamental group of just the variety with the divisor not deleted.
So what you mean is that there is
And so Toledo example maps to omega mod gamma, and certainly pi 1 of t is much bigger than gamma. It's actually an extension by gamma. If you look at that carefully, it's an extension by gamma by an infinite free group.
Ah, okay, thank you very
much. So, but you have this lattice gamma. Okay. And that's, So that's, there is no problem by, the conjecture here I put is stable by passing to, in some sense, it's stable. When passing to subvarieties, it's stable by product. It's stable by, it's birationally stable. So it's extremely stable. And here we knew that Toledo. We had Toledo said that the most important question is this, but with z equals x, which means that we would like to know that if we can construct an infinite pi 1 with no representation. And we try and I try and I try and I try and I fail and I fail and I fail, right? So anyway, but here the reason for the failure of getting a counterexample is interesting. You know, you have to find TQFT representations which are not really familiar to us. If you do that business with rank 2 lattices or lattices of bigger rank, then it is true by Margulis normal subgroup theorem. I have tried to do it this with rank 1, and it tends to be true because there are certain kind of automorphic forms. So it's always a non-trivial reason. And for the moment being, the reasons are completely unrelated to each other. That explain my failure to find a counterexample.
So, any other questions? So, thank you.